you're in the church and you're the right age and you want to go to camp, reach out and let Brent know, and he can help guide you through it. Summer camp is always a vital outreach for us, for our young people, and so church camp registration time is here. Speaking of church camp, they need, for all the campers down there, they need to feed them and water them and take care of them while they're there. And so they need supplies. This year they've asked us for juice, so individual juice bottles. I would imagine that they will take those juice boxes as well, would be my guess. They'll take whatever we give them. And so if you are so led and inclined that you want to donate some juice for the camp, it can be left here at the church. If you're not able to get it to the church, we'll figure out some way to get it from you. So just keep that in mind. Any other announcements? What am I missing? Anything? No? Okay. If you're watching online, I don't know, are we streaming now, Dwayne? We are. Okay. If you're watching online, let us know you're out there. We appreciate you being there. We want to interact with you as much as we can. If you have a prayer concern, send it in. Jerry Maculak and his right-hand man Braxton are sitting in the control booth monitoring the live feed as we speak, and they will make sure we get those requests for prayer at the end of the service this morning. So with that in mind, we are in our Sunday school class studying sanctification, okay? Walking the walk, being what he's called us to be, experiencing the fullness of his joy, and living an abundant life. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, jumping ahead in our study a little bit this morning, is going to be our scripture reading. The Apostle Paul says this, "Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on, that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." You know, as we drive through this life, the rearview window or the rearview mirror is small. The windshield is big. If you're driving down the road and you're spending too much time looking in the rearview mirror, you're certainly going to run into the ditch. The Apostle Paul tells us here, we should be looking through the windshield. We're moving forward. We're striving ahead to become who he's called us to be.
Thank you. Yeah.
This morning I'd like to look in John chapter 6, and starting in the 53rd verse. Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is the food indeed, and my blood is the drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds me will live on because of me. This is the bread in which came down from the heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. Whoever eats this bread will live forever." Jesus came to this earth for us. He died for our sins, that if we believe in him and abide in his will, that we can see him again in heaven and live with him eternally. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and thank you for being in your house to be able to worship you, Lord. Lord, we pray and thank you for your Son and coming down and paying that price that we cannot pay, for providing us life eternally. Lord, we owe everything to you, and we thank you each and every day for that life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Elementary age kids can be dismissed to go downstairs for children's church. And we are going to be in Acts chapter 4. We're going through the book of Acts. And in chapter 4, we still find the church in its infancy. And as I say that, one of the interesting things about having kids of my own and knowing small kids is that they, their personality traits, and traits that they'll possess later in life appear very early on. So my son, Mike, I'm sorry, I have to talk. He's the age where he doesn't like this, but I kind of have to still talk about it sometimes. Even this can boil down as something as simple as sleep. All right, now, Micah, to this day, is often, when he goes to sleep, at the time we send him to sleep, has trouble falling asleep. His bedroom is directly above our living room, where I'll watch TV in the evening, and I'll kind of hear him rustling around and moving around. He doesn't easily drop into a peaceful sleep, and he's often the first one up in the morning, too, and I'm just like, hey, sleep is great. Why don't you try? But, like, he has always been this way. I remember when we brought him home from the hospital, a day or two old, we had to rock him in a particular way, with particular sounds, particular motions, and then set him down, lower him, it's like a Mission Impossible type situation, into his crib, and then slowly sneak out of his bedroom. And if there are any loud noises, if a cell phone rang, my dad's cell phone always woke him up, because like guys his age, it was set on blast. Someone rang the front door, he would wake up, right? And you know, comes by it honestly, he gets it from me and from my mom. He will always probably have trouble sleeping. But like if you knew him on the first day he was born, that's the way he is. The youngest member of our church, the youngest person who attends our church is Emmy Godwin, right? Is she in here? Is she in there? Okay. There she is right there. All right. I've known her entire life. She kind of avoids me. I don't know. Kids are a good personality or character or whatever. She doesn't talk to me. But like just from watching, and she's two, right?
Yes.
Two. Just from watching the way Emmy walks around and her facial expressions, I think I can probably tell, like if I went to a coma, Rip Van Winkle style, for 20 years and met her, I don't think I would be surprised about the person that she's become. Because you have an idea from a very early age, the traits and personality and character of a person. And the same is true of the church and its infancy that we find in Acts chapter 4. And that is important because the essential character of the church, the body of Christ, should remain to today. So when we look at what the church was in its early days, that's what we should model our church family to be like and our Christian lives to be like. I want to talk for a minute about timeline. Because in Acts chapter 1, Jesus ascends to heaven. 50 days later in Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost happens, the church is born. And then we don't know how long there is between chapter 2 and chapter 3. The way I always thought about it and imagined it, it was like, hey, the next week this happened, but the timeline is a little tricky, the chronology, but it seems like they were in Jerusalem at least a year or two, so this could have happened the next month or even the next year or maybe 2 years later. In Acts chapter 3, there's this gap of time, and what happens in chapter 3 precipitates what happens in chapter 4. In chapter 3, Peter heals in an instant a 40-year-old man who had been lame from birth. And they were on their way to the time of afternoon prayer, so there was a crowd of people who knew this man and saw that he had been healed. This was causing quite commotion, and whenever there's something interesting happen, people stop and observe. Some would even say they were gawking at what people still do this today. And Peter addresses them and says, the power of Jesus has healed this man, that Jesus was God's chosen one who you wanted to be crucified, but God raised him from the dead, and you should repent so that God would forgive you. And he says this all very publicly out in the open. And chapter 4 is sort of the consequences or fallout from what happens to this. The religious leaders did not like that. In fact, in Acts chapter 4, the first verse, I think it says they were greatly annoyed by it. So it was late in the afternoon, they arrest him, Peter and John. The way that their legal system worked, it was too late in the day for a hearing, for them to be talked to that day. So they had to spend a night in jail. And chapter 4 tells us how they responded, Peter and John, and what that says about the early church. I want to highlight three things. First one might be easy to overlook. And that is when Peter and John acted, and they're the only people about the church that we know about from this chapter specifically. And they were the leaders. when they acted, they spoke and acted in Jesus' name. Now, some of that is lost on us culturally, but doing something in someone's name is something that is prevalent in the Bible. For example, back in chapter 3, when Peter healed the lame man, he said, "In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." And then when it was a question was, "Well, how did you do this?" he tells the crowd, and his name, Jesus' name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and that faith is through Jesus, has given this man the perfect health in the presence of you all. It's Peter from the south, y'all there. It's like that. Say, we're doing this in Jesus' name. And as I was reading some scholars about this, that is a powerful thing because a name represents a person. A name is an expression of a very person's essence, and then even the name of Jesus represents his divine authority and continuing power. So when the apostles were acting in Jesus' name, they were in some way asserting the very authority of Jesus over the situation in which they found themselves, which was very bold. And this did not escape the attention of the authorities, because when they had set them in their midst, they inquired, this is verse 7, I believe, "By what power or by what name did you do this? Heal this man." And then we get the response in verse 8 of Peter. "Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit," which is important. The book of Acts is a sequel to the book of Luke. Luke is clearly about Jesus, and we'd say it'd be easy for us to say, well, then Acts is about Jesus' apostle. It's not about his apostles. It's about the Spirit is working through the apostles to accomplish God's purposes for the world. And one of the questions I want us to look at is, like, how does the Spirit work in the lives of believers? Because that is a thing that is, like, easy to misconstrue. It would be very easy to say, the way God is leading me is to this. Often we can take what we want to do and say, well, I think God wants me to do that. Someone told me the other day, I heard of someone say, God called me to eat mac and cheese for dinner. I'm like, I don't think that's the sort of thing that God is calling people to do. As great as mac and cheese might be, what he's doing here is Peter, a fisherman, uneducated, and from what we see in the gospel, very impulsive, lacked self-control. They filled him, the Spirit filled him, and gave him the words to say in that moment. He said, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." And so we begin to see the power of a name. I want you to imagine a fictitious scenario. I had to buy a new shovel a couple of weeks ago to do some work in my lawn and garden. Typically I might go up to the hardware store in Jamestown. I like shopping local. Mr. Frost owns the hardware store, correct? That's the one. So imagine I go into the hardware store and say, "You know what? I would like a new shovel, but I think you should just give it to me. I should not pay for it. I should just take it." Now, what would their response be to that scenario? They'd laugh at me. "Who are you? Get out of here." Or they may think, is this the guy's way of trying to rob us, right? Certainly not getting the shovel that way. Think about if my odds were increased, though, if I said this. I walked in and said, "I know this is highly unconventional, But I talked to Mr. Frost, and he wants you to give me a new shovel, no charge. Now then, they would have to at least stop and think about it, right? Why? Because I used a name. Asking with someone's name. I don't ever feel comfortable even doing that sort of thing. Dr. Sheridan has said, if you need to get in an emergency, get an appointment really quick, same day, say that you know me. Use my name with the receptionist. And I always feel like I would hate to do that. I think I've maybe done it once or twice, but I'm like, hey, I know him. He knows, he would want you to let me say, but I'm just like, but that name might do something. If I said, I need to see him at 9 o'clock, not gonna happen. The name means something. Now back to the situation. You know what, if I went to the hardware store, what they'd do? They'd call and say, you know what, maybe when you invoked this name, you could get a free shovel. But we're gonna call and confirm it. We're gonna double check it, which is fair enough, right? Now here's the thing. How did the apostles, how did the people around there know that Jesus, they were acting in Jesus' name? One reason is they were doing, the apostles in Jesus' name were doing some of the exact things that Jesus was doing months and years earlier. One of Jesus' last miracles in John was to heal a 40-year-old blind man who was blind from birth. Here their disciples are healing a man who is 40 years old, blind from birth. Jesus healed the blind. The confirmation that the disciples were effectively and legitimately acting in Jesus' name was the fact that they were doing the same things that Jesus did. There was proof. Now, all of us would say, hey, we need to act in Jesus' name. But the struggle here is to compare apples to apples and not apples to oranges, because, boy, if we could go out on the street today and I could rub my hands together and heal someone, that would be maybe a tool. I don't even know if it would work, to be honest with you. That would be one way to act in Jesus' name. But that doesn't work anymore. At least as far as I know. And so I want us to ask, what in our life can and should we do in Jesus' name? When you are acting in Jesus' name for someone like Peter did, it is important that the person on the receiving end knows that this thing is done in Jesus' name. I think if Peter tried to heal this man with his own power, he would not have been able to do so. But you and I can do things for other people. For whatever reason, the person does not know why we would do it or not. I was thinking, Jamie and I were talking about how to help or at least acknowledge the people outside of McDonald's standing with the cardboard box asking, the cardboard sign asking for help. And we had a conversation about, like, what are the resources that are available? What are the unintended consequences of helping in a way that we may be inclined to help? And we kind of landed on, look, we would like to help those people in that situation, but we landed on a gift, like a $5 gift card, all right? So, like, this can actually help you with a real deal. But Jamie had this idea, and I would credit her fully with it. Like, we should put that in an envelope and say, and write on it, you are fearfully and wonderfully made on the envelope with a scripture reference in Psalms, so that this communicates, we are not doing this for whatever other reason that we have. We are doing this because we love Jesus. He is our Lord. He values you, and this is what we are called to do. It's all about where we are directing our focus, intention, and please do not get bogged down in the idea that it's only this specific thing that we're talking about. Any time you're doing anything for another person or in the name of Jesus, this applies. Like, we need to do it so that those who receive it know that it's because we love Jesus and he loves them. It would be easy just to give someone something or do something for someone, whatever it is, and say, you know what? I'm such a good guy that I'm helping you out. And after I help you, what you're going to think is how great I am. Or it can be either be, if you want to be cynical, is I want my conscience to be able to sleep well at night, so I don't want to feel guilty about having such a great life while you're out here, so I'm going to give you something. It could be all that. And so we have to act in Jesus' name. When we are serving Jesus, we should do it explicitly. People should not be unclear about why we are doing what we are doing. So if there's someone you serve or sacrifice for, they know you, there's a level on which they probably already understand this, but we have to make it clear if we want to be like the early church. The fact that we are followers of Jesus means we can act in his name because we bear his name. Now, some of the weight of this is lost on me because I have a last name Smith, all right? So if you meet someone and they say the last name Smith, they never say, oh, my neighbor is a Smith, or are you related to them? Because there's like 3 million of us in the United States. What you get instead are these bad jokes. Hey, are you related to Emmett Smith? Ha, 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 ha. No, I'm not related to Emmett Smith. We're not all related. Are you part of the Smith Brothers cough drop conglomerate? No, I'm not. There's 3 million of us. All right? In fact, there's 3 Brent Smiths in Greene County. I just know this because we frequent the same businesses. And at one place they said, are you the Brent Smith here, here, or here? All right? And so I don't get the feeling, oh boy, I am representing the Smith name because the Smith name is just kind of anywhere. But if you have a name that's a little bit less used, then there's a real sense in which you are really representing that name. So there's this website that I found fascinating. Maybe it was just me, but we'll see. And you can type in a last name and tell you how many people there are with that last name in the United States and across the world, all right? I thought this was a good tool because the less there are, the more you're representing the name, right? So if you are in, I don't know, let's make something up, Troy, Ohio, and you're in an AAU basketball game, and you see a girl with the name God Love on the back, you definitely know who that is, right? That's Addie God Love. Because there are only 3,000 God Loves in the United States. All right? So, or if you are driving down the road, let's pretend they don't know each other. And Officer Hollingsworth pulls someone over, he sees their driver's license, and it says the last name Sheridan. He knows, well, they have to be related to Dr. Sheridan, because there's less than 1,000 Sheridans in the entire country, right? Here's the extreme example, what I call Last of the Mohegans. If Braxton Magulak is in a class, right? You're not sitting there wondering, I wonder which Magulak he's from, right? Because according to what I said, there's only 16 Magulaks in the entire country, right? So you know he is part of that family. And the reason that I bring this up is because there's this intensity based on what your last name is that, all right, I am really representing this name. This name being attached to me means something. If you are a Christian, if you are a follower of Jesus, you bear the name of Jesus. You represent him in your family, at your work, at your school, and in your community. those within your circle of influence who might not be Christians, they are drawing conclusions about what it means to be a Christian from you. Not only that, they are drawing conclusions about who Jesus is based on their impression of you. That is what it means to bear the name of Jesus. That can be a really good thing, or it cannot be. Here's where the comparison breaks down of representing Jesus to the people in our life. Part of social norms is introductions include your first and your last name. Your name is an unavoidable part of operating in society and part of your identity. It's just out there. It's on your mail. When your kids are at school, their name is known. It's part of your identification process. But people don't necessarily have to know if you're a Christian or not. You don't have to tell them. Or you can talk about it as if it's not that big of a deal. Now here's what I'd say. There's a way in which the Christian message is swimming more and more upstream against society. It's becoming more and more unpopular. You can even see verse 12 here, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. If you want to be right with God, it has to be through Jesus Christ. No other way. All right, so we can understand that's an unpopular message, and maybe we want to... There's a situation where we want to keep our different baskets separated, so to speak. I love Seinfeld, and there's George is a character that I love, George Costanza, and he was trying to keep his friends and his fiance's family separate so that they never interacted with it. And when they overlapped, he said, it's worlds colliding, Jerry. It's worlds colliding, and I sort of understand that. Like, sometimes we say, you know, it'd be a lot less complicated if people did not know what my faith was. I can keep that over here and this over here. But if we are really living and speaking in the name of Jesus, we can't really operate that way. A test might be how long or maybe how well does a person have to know you before they find out you were a Christian. You are a Christian. Which leads to my next point is the second aspect or character trait of the church of Christians was they were relentless in their proclamation of Jesus. The religious leaders wanted this situation to go away as quietly as possible. They were trying to calculate, well, how are we going to accomplish this? Keep in mind that the early church had already converted thousands of people, and alienating those people by harassing Peter and John more than necessary may result in a riot. So we're just going to tell them not to talk. So it says, they called them and charged them not to speak and teach at all in the name of Jesus. Hey, just stop what you're doing, and then we'll let you go. Now put yourself in the apostles' shoes, Peter and John's shoes. They have been arrested. I've never been arrested before. I think it would be a scary experience. I intend on not getting arrested anytime soon. Hopefully never. Who could say, though? So they've been arrested. They had spent a night in jail. Like, the idea of spending a night in jail, I've been to a jail, I've been to a prison before, not as an inmate, but I'm like, I do not want to be there, not for an hour, much less overnight. That's not a place to be in. So they've been arrested, they've been in jail, and then they get pulled before this body that is the equivalent of the Supreme Court of their day, and they're standing before these religious officials, and now they have been given this specific mission. But maybe they start to do this calculus and say, well, let's play our cards right here. Let's play this super smart. Let's be discreet. Let's live to fight another day. Let's tell them that what they want to hear, and let's get out of here. Does that sound like reasonable? Like if it wasn't religion, we would maybe operate that way? Let's be very pragmatic here. You're in trouble. How can we get out of it? Peter and John answered them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. They said, we won't stop because we can't stop. This message that Jesus rose from the dead, we're going to speak it as long as there's breath in our lungs. That was their attitude. And if we want to be the church that he's called us to be, the church that is similar to that one, we have to have the same point of view. Most of us know what it's like to be around someone who is just relentless, just will not stop. Micah's track season just finished a couple last Saturday. And I sat with the same dad, a friend of mine, Josh Michael, during the most of the track meet, and he always had his younger son, who was not involved in the track, there with him. And this, one of the key sort of eccentricities of this young man is that there's nothing he loves more in the world than a concession stand at a sporting event. All right? An illogical passion, he loves. He just loves concession stands. All right? I like concession stands, right? He loves them. And so this was one up near Springfield. We were there. And we sit down about 5 minutes later. He said, Dad, can I have $1 to buy something? Well, he started higher. He's a good negotiator. He started high, moved to the middle, right? And his dad said no. So he would go off and do something, play in the grass or whatever. 5 minutes later, he said, hey, Dad, can I have some money for a concession stand? No, you can't. I'm going to feed you dinner when we leave, which was like 9 o'clock at night at that point. And so every 5 minutes, I shouldn't say his name. I'm sorry, I about slipped out. He comes back. Can I have money for a concession stand? He was down to like, I just want 50 cents to buy a bag of chips. And finally, at 5:30 in the afternoon, his dad said, sure, I'll buy you a bag of chips. And as he didn't have change, so he takes that dollar. He goes, gets a bag of chips, and his dad asked me, well, how long is it going to be? Well, I asked him, how long is it going to be before he wants that other 50 cents again? And his dad said, I think it'll buy me at least a half an hour. And I laughed. I was like, no way it's going to last you a half an hour. 15 minutes at the best. We looked at our watch, 5:30. He eats his bag of chips at 5:46. He said, can I have that other 50 cents, right? On and on again. I mean, all this kid talked about was going to the concession stand. He would not let it go. Last Saturday, we were at the conference meet in Cedarville University. They had a Young's Dairy food truck there, all right? That's a concession stand on steroids. And I'm not kidding you. His dad had no sooner sat down. And he said, can I have some money for the concession stand? And I started busting out laughing because I'm like, and so it begins. Like, this is all day what it's going to be. And as I laughed, he looked at me with a smile like, yeah, you know, and I know you know, right? And I bring up the situation because it feels great to not be in that situation where you're the one with the kid. I call it, my kids, I say it's like having a dog with a bone. They just won't let it go. You know what I'm talking about? Got people all across your life this way. They're like a dog with a bone. They are not letting this go. And what we have to say is the degree to which we should be like that in proclaiming Jesus to those who don't believe or know, are we? Are we persistent enough? How bold are you in sharing Jesus with those around you, with those who don't have a living faith in Jesus? Now, we need to use discretion and discernment. You don't want to be over the top. You don't want to be nagging. You don't want to be in your face and pushy. That will turn people off. It is like dealing with a high-pressure salesman. But we're walking a fine line. We don't want the pendulum to swing the other way. We don't want to overreact and not say anything to anyone ever. So they were acting and speaking in the name of Jesus. They were persistent about it. And third, they prayed powerful prayers. The end of chapter 2 says, they were, the church body was devoted to prayer. At the end of this trial, hearing, whatever it is, the religious officials eventually release Peter and John. They kind of have to. They're between a rock and a hard place. An undeniable miracle has been done with this middle-aged man who had previously been afflicted his entire life. And the apostles were preaching Jesus' resurrection, and they couldn't disprove that either. They knew that Jesus had died. They know where he was buried, but they could not produce his body. So they were between this rock and a hard place, and they said, you know, there's these two irritating guys, and we've got to let them go. And so Peter and John, they return to their group, and they pray, and they thank God that he had protected them from their first moment of real adversity on the basis of their faith. And once they prayed, this is what happened. And when they prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. So they prayed huge prayers. And for us to do the same, we must first ask, am I praying about too narrow a set of things? Should I be praying bigger, more expansive prayers? Jesus' model prayer says that we should say, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that means, like, I need to be praying not just for a very narrow set of things, but what I do. God's will for my life is for me, and I must do some things and not others. And so I have a choice as to whether God's purpose for my life is met or not. And so our prayer should be, God, please help me be what you want to be. But we know for sure, for certain, that through the Spirit, people speak boldly for Jesus and act in his name. We are asking, we should be asking to be someone who proclaims Jesus to other people. Because if you look at exactly what the Spirit did in their lives, it's when they were in their lives willing to speak boldly about Jesus, the Spirit filled them. And then after they had, the Spirit filled them again, so that they were able to continue doing what the Spirit intended, had caused them to do in the first place. And so, as we close today, what we have to really consider ourselves for ourselves is, how authentic of a believer do I want to be? That church in Acts, to me, sounds awesome, exciting. And boy, I don't ever foresee a day where, like, we're praying and the building actually rattles and shakes. But I think there could be where we are praying sincere and power enough praise that the lives of those around us, our lives, will be shaken up and changed. So as we leave, we need to be fully aware that if I'm a Christian, I represent Jesus to the world, and when I'm acting in his behalf, I should be acting in his name. Any act of kindness or service, we must be absolutely clear. I'm doing this because I love Jesus and he loves you. And again, there's a fine line about how boldly we proclaim Jesus' name. There is a line which we certainly don't want to cross, but we don't want to err on the side of being so cautious that we miss out on opportunities that God has sent us to do. This book of Acts is about the Spirit. And we see it operating within all believers, but we are told very early in the book of Acts that is everyone who repents and is baptized will have that same Spirit given to them as a gift. And so, if I I want that Spirit to be acting in my life. It's not a mystery as to what it does. It's leading me to, empowering me to act in the name of Jesus and boldly proclaim His name. Now, if you don't bear the name of Jesus, if you are not a Christian, if you've not had your sins forgiven, and we are all sinners who needs God's grace and who are beneficiaries of His saving death and His resurrection, we're going to have an invitation right now. And if you need to accept that invitation, the way to do it is as follows. You must first have a deep, abiding faith in Jesus Christ that He can take away your sins of your past, that He can lead you in the future, and that He's provided, that He leads you in the present, and He provides for you a great future. And then we ask that you make, because of what we see in the Bible, a public profession of who Jesus is. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? The answer needs to be yes. People need to know that. It cannot be a secret about what you believe. And then people, we are asked to repent, to change our posture towards sin, because it is what caused Jesus to die on the cross, and then to be baptized, become one with His death, burial, and resurrection. So we're going to sing an invitation hymn. If you have that decision to make, come forward at any point while we stand and sing it. For those of us who are Christians, it is a matter of how do I represent Jesus, act in His name, proclaim Him to people. Let's go ahead and let's stand and sing. Thank you. We're so thankful that you could join us on this pleasant spring day. As far as prayer requests that were added, Nancy Kelly asked the prayer for her family. Nick Vandervoort passed away on May 19th, so pray for her family. If there's nothing else, we will close in prayer. Dear God, I thank you for each day of life that you give us. I thank you for the love that you showed us by sending your son to die on the cross for our sins and to redeem us through his resurrection. And I just pray that as we approach your throne, that you will be in every situation that we have mentioned this morning for prayer. I pray that you will comfort the family who has lost a loved one, and that they will know that your spirit is with them, your presence is with them during this time. God, I help you, help us have the boldness to live as you call us have, to live in this world. Help us to see it as a privilege to bear your name and proclaim you, and not a burden. I pray you will strengthen our minds and our hearts for the task. I thank you now for the opportunities that you will give us this week to do so. Help us to be wise in those. God, we thank you for the hope that you give us. We thank you for your son and the eternity that awaits. Thank you for giving us hope in Jesus each day. It's his name we pray. Amen.